I now hand the conference over to Mr. Rajeev Mittal, Managing Director and Group CEO. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you. Dear friends, good evening. Let me first welcome you all to the earnings call post-announcement of Q4 FY21 results of VATech Vabag Limited. Joining me today for this earnings call is Mr. Sandeep Agarwal, our Group CFO. We hope you all had a chance to go through the results update. The world, especially India, is going through a tough phase on account of second wave of COVID-19 pandemic, which has taken heavy toll on livelihood and also on lives. I wish you all the best of health, and let us all hope that we get through the second wave of pandemic and emerge as more resilient, global, and much more economically and environmentally responsible. At Vabag, we have taken all necessary health and safety measures at our sites as well as in offices to ensure good health and well-being of our employees and laborers. Our endeavor at Vabag has always been to be amongst top three global water solution provider. I'm extremely happy to note that Vabag is now amongst the top four private water operators across the globe, ensuring safe and clean drinking water as well as sanitation. This is indeed a proud moment for all of us at Vabag and also all our stakeholders. At Vabag, health and safety is of paramount importance and is an integral part of our culture. As a result, Vabag has secured four prestigious awards among a tough competition from 220 entries at the Environment, Health and Safety Excellence Award organized by CII South Zone. Moving on to our performance for the year, we witnessed improvement in economic activities and progress in Q3 itself, and we saw further improved across the globe as we progressed into Q4. Our construction and supply chain reached near pre-COVID levels in Q4. In fourth quarter, our capital project team, led by Mr. Varadarajan, achieved the financial closure of two HAM projects in our order book. In KMDA HAM project, we have partnered with IFC Washington and Tata CleanTech for the project debt funding, and Eversource Capital will be our equity partner. The financial closure was completed in February 2021. Design, engineering, and ordering activities are nearing completion. Construction work at site has already started. In the Digha-Kanjurmarg HAM project in Bihar, we secured the project debt funding from PTC India Financial Services and achieved the financial closure in March 2021. As you know, in Digha-Kanjurmarg project, we are already progressing on the DBO portion of the contract. Now, with this financial closure, the design, engineering, and ordering work on HAM project is accelerated and already in the advanced stages. Construction work is also expected to start soon. I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate the team for this wonderful achievement and wish to see many more such successes going forward. Coming to some of the key project updates, our Doha South project in Qatar is being executed for Public Works Authority towards rehabilitation of South Doha Sewage Treatment Facility using advanced technology to treat additional sewage, which will be generated from the football stadium constructed for the FIFA World Cup 2022. These projects include rehabilitation of existing plant while simultaneously maintaining the plant performance during the project phase. Detail engineering is complete. All the long lead items have been ordered and delivered to site. Civil works for the new units, digester, side stream filtration, bulk storage tank is also complete. We have started phased commissioning of the project and expected to complete the same by this year end. Our Marafiq project in Kingdom of Saudi Arabia to design and build a large sewage treatment plant with a capacity of 120 million liters per day for Jubail Industrial City is progressing well. We have completed engineering and ordering activities with most of the items already delivered at site and balance in advanced stages of manufacturing. Site civil works have progressed well and with utmost focus on health, safety and environment, where the project has achieved a major milestone of 4 million safe man hours. Coming to our Zarat project in Tunisia, the seawater reverse osmosis plant of 50 million liters capacity expanded to 100 MLD is being executed. The project is progressing well with engineering and ordering nearing completion. Civil works at site are at peak. Equipment deliveries and installation has commenced. Delivery of intake and outfall pipe at site has also been completed. At our 300 MLD independent sewage treatment plant at New Jeddah Airport in Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, which is being built with the state-of-art NEREDA technology for first time in the region, the project is progressing well. Amid global pandemic climate, we have achieved approval of basic engineering packages. Detail engineering and procurement activities are in full swing. Construction activities from the customer side is also progressing well at site. In our 30 MLD seawater desalination plant being executed for Mangalore Refinery and Petrochemicals Limited, engineering and procurement activities are complete. Equipment have been delivered at site and civil works are in the final stages of completion. Seawater intake structure and cross-country pipeline work has been also completed. We expect to commission the project within Q2 FY22. In our effluent treatment plant being executed for Purolite in Romania, which includes 15 years of operation and maintenance, engineering and procurement, as well as construction activities are complete and the project is currently under commissioning phase. We expect to complete the commissioning of the project next quarter, which will be 3 months ahead of schedule. Thereafter, Vabag will run the operation and maintenance of the plant starting H2 FY22. Moving on now to the key financial highlights for the year, I'm delighted to inform you that with our continued focus on cash management and debt reduction, we have returned to net cash position of rupees 44 crores this year and once again generated free cash flow of rupees 96 crores and operational cash of rupees 135 crores. Our gross debt has reduced over the last 2 years from 613 crores in March 19 to rupees 520 crores in March 20 to 350 crores in March 21. We are proud of the team for this significant achievement. I also would like to highlight the performance metrics of our core business for FY21. EBITDA of core business for the year stood at 9.6% against a reported EBITDA of 7.7%. Core PAT of the business for the year stood at 5.3% against a reported PAT of 3.9%. Return on capital employed, ROCE, of the core business stood at 21.4%. Core net working capital days stood at 58 days for the year. Our core business, which is water technology business, remains intact and continues to grow profitably. With a high quality of order book close to 10,000 crore and also an excellent order pipeline visibility, we are confident of another good year's performance to generate value for our stakeholders in our growth story. I would like to express my sincere thanks to our direct and indirect employees and all the stakeholders, including our customers, suppliers, investors, and bankers, for their continued support, especially during these pandemic times. I would now request Sandeep to take you through the financial highlights for the year. Over to you, Sandeep.
An opportunity to look at the results update presentation had circulated and uploaded on our website. Now let me take you through the key financial highlights for the quarter and the year ended 31st March 2021. Our consolidated revenue from operations stood at 2,835 crore. It's almost up by 11% as compared to previous year. On a standalone basis, the revenue from operation was about 1,843 crore, up by 6% as compared to previous year. Revenue from EPC projects grew by 10%, and O&M has grown higher than EPC, which is about 17% year-over-year. EBITDA for the year stood at 219 crore on consolidated basis and 170 crore on a standalone basis. Our EBITDA margin, excluding Forex gain loss and divestment gain what we had last year, has largely remained intact on year-on-year basis. Profit after tax attributable to owners for the period stood at 110 crore on consolidated basis, up by 21%, and at 73 crore on standalone basis, up by 24% from the previous year, representing a profitable growth. For the quarter, our consolidated revenue was 1,000 crore at 27% year-over-year growth, and standalone revenue was 700 crore or 42% year-over-year growth. As it has been our endeavor, we returned to net cash position of rupees 44 crore in FY21. Our gross debt has reduced by 33% from March 2020, and our net interest cost by 48% on consolidated basis on account of significant debt reduction. Our net working capital stood at 97 days. Debt reduction has been a prime agenda of the management to improve the liquidity level of the group, and our efforts are showing the expected results. Continuing our focus on cash management, we continue to generate free cash and operational cash for the second consecutive year. During FY21, we generated free cash of 96 crore on consolidated and rupees 69 crore on standalone basis, and positive operational cash flow of 136 crore on consolidated basis and rupees 105 crore on standalone basis. We thank our bankers, vendors, investors, and other stakeholders for the continued support extended to us during the year and going forward. With this, we open the floor for question and answer. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on your touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets when asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. first question is from the line of Sudhir Bera from Right Time Consultancy. Please go ahead.
Sir, good afternoon and congratulations on strong set of numbers, sir. And also congratulations for turning net cash positive and being ranked fourth in the world in the private water operator.
Thank you very much.
Sir, my questions are two questions. We have generated 136 crore of cash, that is correct, from the operation. But last year it was 244. So it is a muted cash flow from the operation this year. And sir, how do you see this receivable moving? Because if you take current, non-current, and due from one of the customers, which we know, so it is amounting to almost 2,900 crore, sir. 1,349 crore from the current receivable, 547 non-current receivable, and other assets. One receivable which is classified into other assets is almost probably around 1,000 crore. So how do you see these receivables are moving going forward? And other question is, since the input cost have gone up, so how do you see your EBITDA moving forward?
Okay. First, thank you for your appreciation. We do appreciate that. Second thing about your receivable, I think if you would compare the same numbers what you highlighted this year versus last year, you would see there is a net movement positive that we, though our top line has gone up by almost 11%, but our receivables have come down by more than 100 crores. Rightly you said, under the different buckets, one, you're saying in the assets, other assets. These are, being an EPC company, there's always some progress cost which we cannot bill. It is not a billed receivable. We don't bill that. And hence, this is not a receivable. It's just the progress cost which we have, which we will collect in the coming months and quarters. As we bill, we will collect that. The other part of our business is always a retention money. And this retention money, you see in most of the contracts during the execution, client deducts about 5 to 10%. And when we complete the project and handover, we get this retention money. And in some cases, a part of the retention money is even paid after the warranty or the defects liability period. So going forward, this will be the nature. Yes, some of the due receivables, which we have done well this year, and we expect to continue this momentum. And in the this year also, our aim is to further bring down the collectible receivables. This will what we will do. And I think your third question
on increasing input cost and, you know, rising material cost and all that will affect our...
During the pandemic time, basically all the costs have gone up. I think you have seen yourself how this... all the metal indexes. I think anybody can go to a London Metal Exchange and see how the metal prices over the last 8 months have gone up, whether it's steel, copper, alumina, everything has gone up. But most of our contracts also have an escalation clause, and we get compensated, if not fully, a substantial part of our increase is compensated by this escalation formula. So going forward, if this continues, which we don't think so, because we believe all the factories are starting production, China exports are coming back. So we expect this escalation in cost will be now controlled and it will start moving down. But as I said, even if it remains high, we are covered to a greater extent by the escalation formula we have on our contracts.
Great, sir. Thanks, sir, for the opportunity and all the best.
Welcome.
Thank you. We would request the participants to please limit your questions to two per participant. The next question is from the line of Mohit Kumar from DAM Capital. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. And congratulations on a very good performance in a very, very tough year. So my first question is, sir, are you willing to give any guidance for FY 22 or you are refraining from giving any guidance given the environment?
I think the second part of your question is what we will go with, because you know under this circumstances when you don't know even next month what is going to be, so there's no point in giving a guidance for the year. As soon as we see a more stability in this environment, which has been very tough for the last 12 months or 15 months, I must say, we would definitely give a guidance. But one thing is, we are very bullish. We definitely see the performance going up in the this year and going forward also. As I said in my speech, that our order backlog has been excellent, and they are good quality orders. Most of them are from multilateral agencies, and also the pipeline which our boys have developed over the last 12 months, which will give results this year, is also very solid. We have a good visibility that we can see good orders both on the industrial side and international markets, where we will increase our order book further.
So the second question is, sir, of course you just touched base upon the order, you know, but can you elaborate on the order outlook, you know, and order finalization for FY22? Do you think the situation improved further on the ground, and you can see a better momentum compared to FY21? I think FY21 was slightly very, very muted for us as far as order inflow was concerned.
I think this we have mentioned in our calls earlier. Definitely it was a strategy, because we already have a good order. We don't want to load too much order in our order book. Then we are open to delays. So we just took a little bit of break, and in the meantime developed an excellent pipeline with good funding and a substantial of part of that order which are going to come this year. You will see international and industrial, where generally the cash flows and margins are better.
Can I expect an order inflow something like FY20 level?
As we said, we refrain in this call at least to give guidance, but I'm sure we are very bullish on our order intake this year.
Understood, sir. Thank you, sir, and best of luck. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Priyanka Biswas from Nomura. Please go ahead.
Yeah, congratulations, sir, for turning net cash after quite some gap.
Thank you.
My first question is, at least on the current receivables and those fronts, so we have seen a substantial improvement this year. So in this regard only, do we see this working capital improvement as sustainable, like let's say over FY22-23? So like, what are the measures that the company has specifically taken to do this? Because what I remember was earlier the receivables levels used to be a bit higher. So what are the measures you have taken? So what is the sustainability on that? And the last part of this question is, there would be certain equity investments, I believe, for our HAM projects from our share of the investments. So what is the HCF outlook on basis of that?
I think the first question, if I may respond, on receivables, you have seen it, and I think the earlier participant also asked a similar question and my response. And you have also seen from the numbers we have been projecting in the last 2 years, there is a tremendous focus on cash management and receivables, and this is what has enabled us to bring down the debt, improve the operative cash, improve the free cash. We have done that. And there is no looking back on it. What good work we have started, we have to make it even better. I think people are focused. We have put that as one of their KPIs, that they have to collect cash, and each project has to be cash positive. We have to negotiate that payment terms and also go ahead and collect cash on time. I think the boys have been doing a pretty good job over the last 2 years, and I assume this will become part of the DNA of the organization, And going forward, definitely this is sustainable. Now, regarding your equity, as we have always told you, and we want to remind if we have new participants here, that we have always been a asset light company, and we want to continue this journey going forward as an asset light company. Now, because there were some opportunities, especially coming out from Namami Gange, where they introduced this model of HAM, being a leading company in the country and also globally, we didn't want to give up this opportunity first to clean some of our rivers, which we think is a social responsibility for a company like us. And second, also there was a huge business opportunity, which was also available to us to clean the rivers. So we came up with a model where we have already closed two projects financially, where our equity contribution will be extremely low. And this kind of projects will definitely keep our position in the market very well. And also, we will invest extremely low equity. Now, like you talk about this large Budco project, Pankarbagh and Diga. This project is almost about 1200 crores. And our equity will be 7 to 10 crores. So you can see on a project of about 1200 crores, where we are going to do EPC and O&M for 15 years, our equity is going to be 1 to 2%. Same thing with KMDL, where our equity will be 15 to 20 crores for a project of the size of about 400 crores. So all this we have structured in a way that we don't invest a lot of equity. At the same time, we remain participant in this project and do our EPC and O&M projects.
So, sir, that was quite a comprehensive answer explaining the nuances. And if I may touch upon this, I know you are not giving a sales revenue guidance as such, but it seems that this quarter you had done like almost close to 10 billion. Last time it was like 8. At least something of this sort of quarterly run rate can reasonably be maintained. Will we be wrong to presume that, or is it a right understanding?
I think you are very experienced. You have been following this company for many, many years now. So I don't think I can make any comments on your assumption. You just have to go by the past track record and see how good is our order book, how our execution is getting the traction, and you should make your judgment. And I'm sure your judgment will not be wrong.
Thank you so much, sir. That's all from my side. If there is something, I will join back.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jonas Gupta from Philip Capital. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir, and congratulations on an improvement in the balance sheet, which was much awaited. A couple of questions. Firstly, sir, if we can get a breakup of this 107 crores that we provided for bad debts in the year, as to how much of this is for the Genco project. Now, if we were to look at a 3 or a 4 year period, sir, we provided in excess of 300 crores in form of bad debts, which now sort of total up to almost 3.8% of sales. Now, going into FY22, do you believe that most of the hit that we were to take on either Genco projects or the other projects is largely behind us, and the bad debts as a percentage of sales should now go back to the historical averages of about 1 to 1.5%? That's the first question.
I think Jonas, you have been tracking this company for a long time, and you did mention about this. So I think our run rate is still in the range of 1.5% to 2%. without Genco. And we think this is sustainable for a company of this size with multiple geographies, what we have been doing over the decades. About 1.5 to 2% is a good number, what you mentioned. And I think as we go along, Genco will become insignificant. So there's nothing more we need to provide on many years to come. Maybe still something more depending on the outcome of some of the legal issues we have. But other than that, I don't think you're wrong in saying that we were always in the range of 1.5 to 2%. I think we should get back to that range.
So, sir, out of the 427 crores of receivables that we have from the GenCos, which are mentioned in the notes to accounts, how much of these have now been provided for, sir?
See, what we are saying, and that is also we have given you a breakup, see, clearly these things are at the legal thing. And you know, for last year and a half, there is nothing has moved at NCLT or in Supreme Court where these cases are, and also at one of the execution sites where the site has been closed for last 1 year because of various issues related to COVID, which we expect that this week we will restart as the state is coming out of the lockdown and we should be able to start that. We expect also the Supreme Court and NCLT should start working within this week, and as soon as it works, I think we should be able to achieve that.
My second question was, if I were to look at your receivables, the reported receivables of 29 billion and take out these 400 odd crores on account of Genco, we are still at about 325 days of receivables, while that has come down because last 2 years average was about 375, 380, which is commendable. But, you know, where do you think that this should normalize, because I'm sure you're not comfortable even with 325 days.
Jonas, to the earlier participant, I don't know whether you were there on the call that time. I think clearly there are, part of it is not even receivables. These are retention monies, which are maybe during the year or some of it over the next 1 or 2 years, they will become receivable as we complete the project and as we complete the warranty period. Okay, so almost a bulk of it will get into that category. At least one third or at least 30-35% of that is just retention. The other part is a progress cost, which is not even something is billed, and because we are progressing over the next few months or quarters, we will bill and collect that. So our collectible receivables are maybe only one third or 40% of it. And that's where we are completely on focus, and we have reduced that substantially, the collectible receivables. Going forward in this year also, you will see the collectible receivables will keep coming down.
Sure. And last one, if I can squeeze in, sir. So the project cost or the order book for the Agra Ghaziabad project has gone up by about 300 crores in the fourth quarter. Can you elaborate on what is this relating to? Has there been an additional scope that got added, or how should one look at it?
See, there are two things, Jonas. One, there is an escalation clause on this contract for 10 years. So each year we will build more than what we build in the first year. And each year we'll keep on building more and more and more. That's number one. Number two, yes, you are right. This is the first time in the country they're doing a one city, one operator, which we had earlier done in the city of Istanbul in Turkey. So as we go along the plants, a lot of refurbishment and replacements have to be done. These are a set formula, cost plus basis, and they keep giving us that refurbishment and replacement of those plants, and we keep adding that. And that adds extra scope to our order book.
So the annual revenue run rate from this project was expected to be about 75-80 crores. What is it now based on the...
No. Jonas, double of that. About 140 to 150 crores, because it's 1,400 to 1,500 crore order in 10
years. Over a 10-year period. Okay, got it. So this additional 300 crores spread by 10 years, so another 30 crores sort of gets added, right?
Yes, and we can also expect as we go along, we will get many more scope change orders, and it will, the closing value can be expected to be much higher than the present value.
So this year we have billed 140 crores.
Yeah, close to it.
Okay. Got it. Thanks a lot, and I'll come back in the queue.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Naman Jain, an individual investor. Please go ahead. Mr. Jain, your line is in talk mode. You can go ahead, please. As there is no response from the current participant, I have muted the line. The next question is from the line of Arunav Chakrabarty from VA Tech Baba. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mittal.
Good afternoon.
How are you, sir?
I am good. Good to hear your voice again.
Thank you. Okay, well, I think most of my questions lie regarding this Abgent, you know, Jain Coolz. Now, August, you said that, you know, by December 2020, we should be able to collect something. But till date, I don't think, you know, we could get anything. So
I don't think I need to answer. You know the answer yourself.
Yeah, I know. But, you know, is there any chance, like once the court opens and all, can you keep some hope on this?
I think we are fully convinced.
Okay.
But as soon as the court opened, we will definitely handle it. And don't worry. I think
okay.
We
will. Okay. And then.
And in the next call, we'll be able to share some good news.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. And second is my pet question, like Chennai Desal project. That JICA and municipality of Chennai, that Desal project, no? That
yes, I understand. I think so, definitely you will be happy that your company, BSF Wabag, we are one of the four qualified bidders. Their pre-qualification process is over.
Okay.
We are one of the four qualified bidders, and we are now expecting for RFP to come, which we hope, now the elections are over, the RFP should come any moment, and we are very hopeful that we will be able to do well on that.
Yes. So, do they declare the L1 contractor?
Oh, no. This is only RFP still not come, so we have not submitted our bid. It's only okay. Pre-qualifications are completed.
Oh, pre-qualifications. Okay.
Process. First is pre-qualification, then the technical bid evaluation, and finally the price bid.
Okay. So what sort of time we can keep it in your mind? Like
we are
by
thinking that it should get finalized in Q4 of this year.
Q4. Okay. By the end of the year, a financial year. January, February.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks a lot for your, and congratulations on the performance of the company. We are improving day by day. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kaushik Poddar from KB Capital Markets Private Limited. Please go ahead.
Yeah, see, this bank charge nearly forms around 1.8% of your turnover. With the improvement of your finances and the rating, do you expect this charge as a percentage to come down?
Yeah, I think, is it a 1.8% is a total charge or
a bank charge? Yeah, I think 54 crore is the charge on a turnover of around 3,000 crores.
Is it only bank charges or is it including the interest?
42.
So it's the bank charges, you're right.
7 crores.
I think if the two things very correctly you have said, one is the rating of the company.
Yes.
We've seen the rating has gone up during the last year.
Yeah.
It definitely helps us to bring down the bank charges. But on the other side, the company's order book has gone up substantially. Which also, we have to give higher amounts of bank guarantees, both for performance and advances, which will also increase our bank charges. And this also has a lot of overseas contracts, where we have a double bank charges because the Indian bank gives it to a corresponding bank in that country, and that corresponding bank on that country gives it to the ultimate customer. So if there are international jobs, the bank charges will be almost double of that of Indian contracts. So as we get more and more contracts and more international contracts, this number is expected to go up.
So can we take it that it will earn 1.8% or it can come down as the turnover goes?
I think around that should be okay, because 1.8% of 2,800. So yes, it is about 1.8%. You are right. I think you should, if you are doing modeling, it's a good number to stay with.
Okay. That's it. Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Ranjit Sivaram from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead. Ranjit, the line is in talk mode. You can go ahead, please. We would request you to unmute yourself if muted from the handset.
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yeah, much better.
Sir, just wanted to congrats on good set of numbers. Good to see the cash flows coming back. But when I analyze your cash flow, it's largely because of our increase in payables that we are still able to manage the positive cash flow. So if you look at the other current assets have been actually increased. So
I disagree, Ranjit. You can see from the numbers we have given, the payables at last year was about 800 odd crores. Okay? And then it is 62 crores.
Sir, in the cash flows, actually the payables have resulted in this positive cash flow from
that. 1 minute, let me get the balance sheet.
Ranjit, payables have come down. It has not gone up. Maybe if you look at the overall
cash flow statement, in that the if you look at the trade receivables have increased 78 crores, other financial assets increased 57 crores, and other assets have increased 132 crores, while your payables have increased, and both your payables and other liabilities have increased, and that has resulted in this positive cash flow. I'm just reading out your cash flow statement you have reported. So, and compared to this, it was because of this other assets improvement that you have actually seen the cash flow generation much more. Like you had a 281 crores of cash flow operation last year, and this year it is only 167 crores. So that's what this other assets.
Ranjit, I have the numbers in front of me now. I'm sure you also. Now, if you see the non-current payables is at the same level for a higher turnover, higher sales. Okay? It was 136 crores. Now it is 131 crores. So non-current payables have come down slightly from the last year, from 136 to 131. If you go to the current payables, if you take both for small enterprises and large enterprises put together, we are more or less flat. We were 1,614 last year, and now we have 1,635. So the payables have not gone up. Even our top line has gone up.
Sir, I'm looking at your cash statement that you have reported in the stock exchanges.
But just look at the balance sheet. Now it's straight coming from the balance sheet under the current liabilities and non-current liabilities. That also we have put it to the stock exchange.
Yeah, this yes, sir. But then,
I'm reading from the balance sheet. If you want, I will go to the cash flow statement also.
True, because there is an increase of 132 crore in the other assets.
Other asset increase on the asset side you are talking about,
no? You go to the cash flow statement, changes in working capital. There is a 132 crore increase in other assets, while your trade payables, there is a increase of 62 crore and other liabilities, there is an increase of 43 crore. So these two have actually allowed us to show positive cash flows.
No, just hold on, Ranjit. Just hold on. I'm looking at the cash statement. If you want to look at cash statement, we'll do. But I thought the payables you're talking about, so I gave you straight from the balance sheet. If you want to go to the cash flow, either we can take offline, or if you give us a 30 seconds, I will give you the breakup of that 130 odd crores you are talking about. See, if you're talking about this 62 odd crores, which is payables from the last time, the delta was 80 and this time is 62 crores.
And if you go to the other assets, last year they have actually been positive 156 crores. In compared to that, now it is negative 132 crores. That means that much of other assets have increased, which have actually impacted our cash flows.
Oh, no, don't worry. You want to take it offline or you want me to take the details and give you that?
No, I'm fine. I'll do it offline. No problem. I just wanted to...
I'll tell Karan to call you, because it's clearly what we are talking about. If you take into the payables, which is 62 crores, is basically the Forex element has almost 50% of that. Where is the Forex movement? That is the reason you are seeing that 62 crores. On 132 crores, also I will give you a breakup. But coming to very clearly, the payables have definitely come down. And the right place to see is our balance sheet, where it shows that even for a higher top line, our payables are low.
Okay. And sir, if I look at the, look at the last reported order book breakup and current, is there any realignment or is there any process that you have taken off or some readjustment in the order book, order intake?
Yeah, it has, because these are all dynamic orders. Some of this are item rate orders. If some of the portion is not getting executed, we always adjust, as somebody was asking earlier, whether it is gone up. So both movements we do. If it goes up, we add to it, and if it comes down, we reduce it.
So there is any particular
no cancellation. There is nothing. Not a single order is on hold.
Okay. And was there any large O&M order that we got last quarter?
Offhand, I cannot tell you, but I don't remember of that. That is a large O&M order.
Okay. And lastly, sir, regarding our margins, if you can, of the order book, how much is fixed price contracts and how much is variable price contracts, so that we'll get some idea that this portion of the order book is safe and the other portion can get
impacted. Orders have a variable price index, because these are generally more than 2-3 years, and we have always a variable price index, and these are all multilateral orders. But if you want specific orders, please get in touch with our team. I'll tell my team also. They will give you order by order.
Okay. I'll join back for the question, and thanks for this.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Harsh Shah from Dimensional Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Good afternoon. So when I look at your EBITDA margins on standalone and console basis, so I see that the that our subsidiaries are drag on the margins, because for full year FY21, our standalone margins are at 9.2% while console are at 7.7%. So can you throw some light on that? I mean, why are our subsidiaries not making margins at par with our standalone operation?
It's not a right way to compare this because some of it definitely is the type of projects and the timing of the projects where you have this EBITDA. Some of the projects in India may be in the engineering phase where we have a higher margin, and some of the projects abroad can be in the execution phase where the engineering hours are already consumed. But it's better, I think, you also have to look at how the normalized EBITDA margins are worked, which we also showed you in our analyst presentation, which we have circulated. If you take the forex and the one-time divestment gain, our EBITDA margins for this year are definitely better, both on console and standalone, if you compare like for like, which I'm sure over the next few days you guys will do it. And if you need any help, we can also help you to come to that number.
Fair enough. And sir, you mentioned if we look at our order book, almost 70-75% of it is coming from the municipal. So I believe that it would be backed by either the government or the multilateral agency. And in that case, isn't 1.5-2% of revenue, which you said as bad debt, and isn't it much on the higher side considering that we are working mainly with the governments and the multilateral agencies?
Yeah, that I think perception is right, and that is exactly the reasons we are working with multilateral agencies and also with central government funded projects. There's no difficulty about it, and same thing we do abroad also. But this whatever is the bad debt we are talking about, 1.5-2%, it will happen in every project because these are the projects which are long duration, sometimes 3-4 years. So there are always going to be some mismatch what we believe we have billed and it's due to be paid. During the certification, we get into a discussion with the client and they do not certify 100% of our work. So over the period of time, this discussion goes on, and towards the end, we settle for something where they agree to our claims to a certain extent, and some of this we agree to them that they will not pay us. So this is the nature of the business. I think going forward also, these things have to be done. If there were other things, you can see some other companies will be providing much higher. But we have been always in that range, and going forward also, we'll remain in that range.
Okay. And just touching upon the cash flow statement, once again, sorry for harping on that same line item, which is the increase in other assets. So because the delta itself is quite huge, from positive 156 crore to negative 132 crore, it's almost a delta of negative 285 crore. Now, just for broader understanding, is this because of the year-end accounting? I mean, because our project got delayed by 3-4 months because of the pandemic, and we accounted for these projects late, and because and that's why we are seeing that lumpiness in the in that amount. Because I believe when we say that it is the work which is done but we have not billed, our money gets blocked there regardless of whether we have billed or not, and that takes a hit on our cash flow. So just want to understand the time lag between, you know, recognition of this amount and eventual receipt of the same.
See, I think in a construction contract, there's always going to be a time lag. Like you buy a steel, you buy cement, you buy some pipe. You cannot convert everything into a building overnight. You will have to give some time to convert that steel, cement, all that into a structure, and you can only bill when you reach certain milestone of that structure. So there will always be a time lag between when you pay to get the raw material and when you convert to a billable item. And that is the nature of the business. It will continue. And I think the earlier question which Ranjit, I'm sure he's online, he's getting, my team has given. See, on that, there's a supplier advances because of the increased activity of our execution. There's almost about 35 crores of supplier advances we have paid. And also what suppliers have given us bills for GST, there is an input credit of almost about 60 odd crores, where we have an input credit of 60 odd crores sitting as an asset for us, but we are not able to convert into a payable GST and take the advantage of an input credit because our billing is having a time lag. So about 60 odd crores is sitting as a GST input, 35 crores is sitting as advance. And there is this Ganga STP, which we talked about, the KMD HAM project. We are going to be a minority shareholder. Temporarily, we have done some work of 40 crores and taken some advance. So it is sitting in as a payable. Okay. But next quarter onwards, the equity shareholder will put in equity and he will be a majority shareholder. So this 40 crores will disappear from our balance sheet. So it is only a very temporary that this Ganga STP, which is the KMDA HAM project, is sitting in March. But when we go to the next quarter, it will disappear. When you see the September results, this will not be there. So this is a very temporary thing if you are just picking up the difference of this 132 crores. But as I've told Ranjit and I repeat, if you see our payables are very much in control and lower, if you see the top line has grown by almost 11%.
Okay. And just to cut this discussion short, so we have already recognized these other assets, that is the work has already been done, and from here on we will largely see unwinding of this amount, right, as we start receiving it from the relevant authorities.
Absolutely. I think as we bill, we will be able to take the input credit of GST. As we do work, the advance we have given to our suppliers and contractors, we will be able to liquidate, because every RA bill we will adjust the advance. Yes, going forward this will come down.
And that's it. Thank you so much, sir, and all the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Manish Maheshwari from AUM Capital Market. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, congratulations on very good set of numbers. Sir, our margin trajectory as of now is 7.6-7.7%. Over, say, next few years, are we kind of aiming to achieve a margin trajectory of at least two digit in maybe say two to three years, absolute margins?
I think we have said this in earlier calls also. That is what the team is working to, and I think we are very hopeful that going forward, this is the level the company should be.
Okay, so is this achievable and fairly pragmatically achievable and fairly doable in next maybe 2 years?
Yeah, definitely. It is achievable, and you have seen also in this result that even on our core EBITDA, we are already at, instead of 7.7, if you take this other non-core business, it's at 9.6. So going forward, the water business is at that, and I think we definitely is achievable, is my answer.
Okay. So my second question is that our business is more tilted towards municipal side, right? And the industrial side the contribution of the industrial side is low, right? So I'm also, I'm also sure that we are increase on our industrial side, but the problem, sir, with the municipal side is that there is always a risk of a delay and default in payments, right, from municipal from the likes of municipal corporations, etc. So are we kind of endeavoring to advance upon our industrial business?
See, first thing, your second question first. See, as we have explained to you, even the municipal business, we don't take any business which are state funded. You can see from our order book, they are minuscule. Most of it is either multilaterally funded or sovereign guarantees we have. So I don't see there is any risk of payment not coming from municipal authorities, and that has been something we have decided, and that's how our order book is having a composition of mostly multilateral and central government funded projects. Now coming to industrial versus municipal, we have been one of those companies in this sector who is very comfortable with industrial. In fact, the highest level of engineering and project management skills you need in industrial is in oil and gas. We are one of the top companies, not only in India, but globally, who is doing very well in oil and gas. Likes of who's who in oil and gas, we have done work, and you will see in going forward also, we will pick up a lot of this work. So yes, our endeavor, even this year, if you see the revenue of industrial is almost 25%, and municipal is 75%. Going forward, you will see these numbers further improving in years to come. And that's what the team is working to.
Okay. Sure, sir. So, sir, how are we placed against competition right now? From the likes of Ion Exchange, etc. I mean, if I may ask you.
You're comparing with somebody or your general question?
No, sir, I'm comparing with Ion Exchange. Ion Exchange versus VA Tech Vabang.
Generally, we are not into the same league as Ion Exchange. Ion Exchange has always been traditionally into standard projects, into more point of use of a thing like zero bacteria and standard projects. They just have gone into some of these large projects recently, but our endeavor has always been on large, medium to large and complex projects. We don't do anything which are small standard plants or point of use or manufacture of resins, chemicals. We are not into that business at all. So we are into major and mega projects, and that is where we will continue to be.
Okay. Sir, I was asking you this question with respect to this municipal and industrial. Just a couple of months ago, there was an observation where we actually saw and witnessed that there was some news of Delhi Municipal Corporation defaulting on the payment of some 12-13 crores. And straight away, there was a kind of...
There is a dispute.
Yeah, there was a dispute, right.
We are dealing with it. And I think whether it's industrial or municipal, there's always going to be dispute, and there's a way to deal with it and resolve it. And that's the business we do. In a business of 3,000 crores, 11 crores dispute is normal for us.
Sir, I have a very, very, very close and a profound question now on attributed to which, to my mind, it makes a very, very compelling opportunity for Vabag to play Vabag, sir, which is Nal Se Jal scheme of government. I mean, sir, what are the prospects, fundamentals and the potential that we see, sir? Because 40% decision in India is waterborne, right? And this government is working very, very hard on Nal Se Jal. On Nal Se Jal scheme, right? On Nal Se Jal regime, right? So, So, sir, how bullish are we on Nal Se Jal as an external opportunity for our business per se?
It's a good thing for the country. I think Prime Minister and present government is definitely doing a great job by providing to a semi-urban and rural areas Nal Se Jal. But as the name suggests, this is basically a pipeline project, a construction project. There is no technology involved in it. The treatment plants are much smaller. It's basically conveying the water. We are not a construction company to do this construction of canals or pipelines to do that. Where there is a treatment portion to it, definitely we'll be part of it. I think government's initiative on reuse and recycle, government's initiative on desalination, these are the areas where we can use our technologies, our patents, and we are one of the best in this business, and that's where we focus on. We play from our area of strength, which is technology, not construction.
Okay. So Nal Se Jal per se doesn't bring any excitement or any enthusiasm in the business per se, right?
No, enthusiasm is there. As a good citizen, we always like to see our villages.
I'm asking you specifically with respect to Vabha.
We have an opportunity because Nal Se Jal is also where there is no source of water. The only source of water is desalination. And if they bring desalination plants to supply Nal Se Jal, yes, Vabha is very much there. But if they're just transporting some surface water, then Vabha is not there.
Okay. Sir, I have a last question. The promoter holding has been pretty low for a few years now. Sir, are we contemplating and dwelling upon increasing our stake or maybe looking at creeping acquisition?
I don't know. Probably we are not that rich to do that. You know, we have been a management buyout. We are doing our good management job, and acquisitions of stake is not our priority. Yes, whatever we used to have our spare money, we used to add to that, but this you will not see substantial contribution from the management.
Thank you. We would request the current participant to please come back in the question queue for any follow-up questions, as we have several participants waiting for their turn. The next question is from the line of Omkar, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir. Am I audible?
Yes.
Sir, just wanted to ask the earlier question. My person has already asked these questions regarding Chennai 400 MLD big project. Last time you said ki most probability in quarter one, the final outcome will come. But now you are saying it will take another 6 to 9 months to come a final outcome for Chennai 400 MLD project?
And you know that in February, the code of conduct came
for
the elections in Tamil Nadu, and nothing happens during code of conduct.
Okay.
The result came and the new government is just taking charge.
Okay.
So that's where I think we lost a good 6 months.
Okay. So because of that reason, it is getting delayed.
Yes, yes.
Okay. So as you said, very much it will take another couple of quarters minimum to take a final outcome, right?
But we have to get the RFP and then it takes about 4 to 6 months to submit an offer and evaluate the offer. And being a multilaterally funded project, it also takes their own process of at least 2 to 3 months to recommend for award.
Got it, sir. Thanks for the update. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We would request the participant to please limit their questions to two per participant. The next question is from the line of Sudeep Chatterjee, retail investor. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah.
I just wanted to ask you, when can we expect the company to give dividends? No? Yes.
I think definitely you have seen that we have been continuously dividend paying company from the start of our, after listing of our IPO. only yes. last 2 years because of this investment in the HAM project. So we are trying to increase our business and also participate in the HAM project where equity is required. So that's the only reason. Once we are over with it, I'm sure we will start again.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Arvind Joshi from Batalier Advisors. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening. I just wanted to get some granularity on the landscape that we are targeting in the industrial area, the kind of sectors we are looking at, kind of pipelines we see that, and would our strike rates of about 25% to 30% conversion of the pipeline stay in the industrial sector too, or we could do a little better than that? Thanks.
Definitely, I think, Arvind, we will go better because of our industrial track record has been good. As I said, our competition also on industrial is less. Our hit rate has always been good. So we are expecting good orders this year on the industrial side. And this will also increase our order book on the industrial side.
What could be the rough addressable opportunity that you see over the next 2 years probably?
It's been very tricky because of pandemic. Everybody has right. been postponing their investments, as you have also seen.
Right.
So at the present time, what we have a good visible pipeline, we see a good opportunity to convert that in orders in next 2 to 3 quarters.
And that opportunity would be roughly what, a few thousand crores, 2,000-3,000 crores yeah, totally in the industry?
Definitely that order of magnitude.
Okay. And does our industrial bouquet include the sugar industry, which would now be spending a lot of money because they are putting in more crushing and more effluent control capacities in the whole expansion schemes that are coming up because of government policies? So are we involved in sugar industry, ZLDs, or that's too small for us to play with?
Exactly. That's too small and too risky.
Okay.
To go in there because there's always a payment risk depending okay. on the seasonality of the sugar. Okay. So we don't play in that field.
So it's largely steel and refineries? All in
steel, gas. Refinery, fertilizers. This okay. is the area where there's a large infrastructure spending.
Okay. Okay. Fine. Thank you so much. Thanks and all the best.
Welcome.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Kartikeya Agarwal from SMS Holdings. Please go ahead.
Hello, good afternoon, sir. I just wanted to ask you that like the order book which we generate, is it primarily through competitive bidding or how does that take place?
Most of it predominantly is competitive bidding because these are large government orders. There's very, very little portion of it can be negotiated or variation orders, but bulk of it comes through competitive bidding.
Okay, sir. And as you just mentioned that, you know, the company has been rising through the ranks consistently and we are now the fourth ranked company in the world. So does that also help us while bidding in terms of margins, etc., as we gain more, you know, credence in the industry, or how does that take place?
It definitely helps to build an image of the brand, which also helps in client shortlisting us for bidding. And also inviting us for bidding. And that also helps us to find good partners, good financial and technical partners. And you see that we were the first company for HAM projects where in water sector, IFC Washington has partnered us and agreed to fund the debt portion of it. So these are the definitely things which help us to take a mileage of that.
Okay, sir. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ranjit Sivaram from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. One last clarification. Just there is a 348 crore order intake in O&M. So was there any large order or is that something which we have we have one big order, or is it a coming addition of some smaller orders?
See, as earlier somebody said, a part of it has come from one city, one order as a variation order, and as a also a escalation order from one city, one operator. This is what has come. You're talking about 348 number?
Yeah.
So that is the bulk of it is one city, one operator, where one of the earlier participants had also asked us how this value has gone up, because we got a variation order on one city, one operator, and also the escalation has come, and then the others are balanced smaller orders, Ranjit.
Okay, and anything else from Namami Ganga is pending, or is the, all the ordering for Namami Ganga is complete?
No. We are at the moment, as we talk, we are bidding for two more new projects, and we see more projects of Namami Ganga coming. As you know, it's not only about Ganges or Ganga. They have extended the same scheme for other rivers in the country. So this scheme will continue for decades to come.
Okay, sir. Thanks and all the best.
Thanks, Ranjit.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sumit Budnani, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Good evening. Thanks for taking my call. Just two small questions. One, I've been holding your shares for the last 4 years now, and under the contract, what is this cost of delivery order which shows up?
Your voice is breaking. Are you on mobile?
Is this better?
Well, please try again.
Yes, I was saying that I've been holding your shares for the last 4 years, and I think in most quarterly updates, presentations, there is a contract from Libya under the framework contracts, and that's of a significant amount, a few thousand crores, and it doesn't seem to move from framework to the actual order book. And given the amount of geopolitical issues in that region with constant civil war and warfare, do we anticipate that ever becoming a fulfilled order book, kind of move from the framework to an actual order?
Yeah, definitely. Otherwise, we'll never keep it. If management doesn't believe, we don't put anything in our presentation.
But it's remained there for...
Go ahead, please.
It just remained there for the last 2-3 years.
I will answer you that question.
Sure.
See, we are the largest water sector player in Libya. We have been through good and difficult times, and even as we speak now, we are executing about a couple of orders in the country. We work with a two-pronged strategy where all our engineering and ordering is done from our office in Vienna in Austria, whereas the local work is done by our workforce, which is based in Tripoli. We have a local workforce in Tripoli. They take care of that order. So we have definitely a lot of this thing which is going on, and we are executing successfully, whether it's a desalination plant, whether it's a municipal order, whether it's a water treatment plant or a power plant. So this order, you have seen and you have very rightly said, this order is signed by us. This contract is registered. We have paid a stamp duty to the government. Now, because of this, whatever geopolitical things you said, this is gone behind in their order of priority, because their priority is to provide safe drinking water, and also their priority is to provide power. So we are seeing more traction in the power and desalination. The municipal part is taking a little backseat. But this order is very much there. It's only a matter of time. Anybody else could have taken it directly into order book. But we have a policy till client opens a LC where we can execute this order and draw our money, we will leave it into the framework and will not start working on it. And that's the reason it sits in the framework for last few years. And we still hope that maybe another year it will go, and then it will get its turn to get funding, and they will open the LC. But you see another order in the framework, which is Bomba, MED, that is desalination, that's drinking water. This will be a LC which will be opened much before this STP order. And that exactly what we are executing even now in Tobruk, where we are executing a desalination plant because that is they need a drinking water. And that order is under execution, maybe end of this year, we'll complete that order and this order will get started. And we hope to get very soon in next one or two quarters, this Bomba LC and start executing the desalination plant.
Got it. I think that's very helpful. And one small additional question was regarding competitive intensity. Have you seen that ratchet up specifically from L&T? Because in their earning calls, they've been talking about the water division as one where they have a lot of management focus on and they've been winning orders. Thank you.
Yeah, why not? When the sector is attractive, everybody gets attracted to the sector. And obviously, for them also, I'm sure it will be a focus area. But our focus remains, as I explained to somebody, like Nal Se Jal. We don't get into the construction part, which is what their strength is. So we get into more technology part where we don't need a partner or a technology provider to give us the technology. We have all this in-house technology. So we focus on technology projects where we like to get our share of business from those projects and less focus on construction-oriented projects.
Got it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Manish Maheshwari from AUM Capital Markets Private Limited. Please go ahead.
So, going ahead, are we looking at any small, I mean, any kind of acquisitions? Because a lot of disruptive early to mid stage companies are there doing some commendable work in the water space. So are we eyeing any acquisition per se?
Yes, since IPO now more than 10 years, we have been saying that we want to grow this business more organically. Inorganically, we don't focus on it. But yes, as you said about disruptive technology where we are moving into digital and other areas, if we find some smaller outfits, they have some technology which fits into our technology portfolio, why not? We'll look at it. But there's nothing which we are missing, which we are going after. But if we come across something important, definitely we will do that.
So, sir, I have been tracking, your company for a couple of years now. So, in case if I spot any attractive opportunity, can I personally reach out to you?
Yeah, definitely. You can let me or my team know. We will definitely have a look at it.
Okay, sir. Sir, I'm in touch with Gaurang. So, I'll keep him in loop.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Welcome.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dhananjay Mishra from Sunidhi Securities and Finance Limited. Please go ahead. Dhananjay, your line is in talk mode. You can go ahead, please.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, please.
As the line for the current participant has dropped, I would request Mr. Rajiv Mittal for closing comments.
Thank you everyone for your participation and this Q&A session in our Q4 FY21 earnings call. We have uploaded the analyst presentation in our website. In case you have any further queries, you can get in touch with our Stella IR advisors. our investor relation advisor based in Mumbai, or feel free to get in touch with us directly. Thank you very much. Enjoy your evening. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of VA Tech Babak Limited, that concludes this conference call. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.